Yo, what's up everybody, welcome back to another reaction. Today I'm reacting to Dodging Disbandment and Other Extreme Sports, a History of Dreamcatcher. Now, I don't know if I'm fucking up by like watching this maybe too early or before like an actual guide or something, but to be honest, it's probably not a big deal, and I'm actually very curious to know like why such a high quality group such as Dreamcatcher doesn't have a win yet in music shows. Not saying that wins in music shows are like the most important thing, you know, but I'm just curious why they're not getting the recognition that they deserve, you know, like why they're going so under the radar, at least in Korea, because it seems like international fan bases appreciate them as such. But yeah, it's a long video, pretty long video, 30 minutes. So yeah, let's go. Let's get right into it.
A quick disclaimer before we get into it, I do not have all the facts. And obviously, not every single detail is here. Every statistic used is readily available information for anyone who wants to find it. And as always, this video is not intended to point fingers at certain groups or artists, nor start.
Don't worry about it, man. See, this is what I mean. 2020, you gotta be careful, bro. Everybody trying to cancel each other.
If you love Dreamcatcher more than anything, or you couldn't care less about them, wonderful. That's all cool. I just ask that you leave your opinions about the members, your opinions about the fandom, and your opinions about any other artists mentioned here out of your consideration for the video.
Bet. Wait, Game of Thrones spoilers? Is that a joke or what? I haven't watched Game of Thrones yet. I hope that's like some kind of joke.
Wild story. I'm not 100% sure, but I think they may or may not be caught up in some cosmic duel between two ancient gods.
Oh,
one who
shit.
Wants them to succeed, and one who wants to destroy them at all costs. Dreamcatcher is a girl group under Happy Face Entertainment, and they've been around since 2014. Kind of. The group has released 6 mini albums of reasonable success. Kind of. And they achieved their first win in September of 2019. Kind of. There's a lot to unpack about the history of Dreamcatcher, especially since they weren't even always Dreamcatcher. Over the years, the group has attracted a rather convoluted legacy, and when you look at it all laid out, there's something about Dreamcatcher that seems to be constantly dodging out of the way of danger. While there have been some touch-and-go moments regarding failure or even disbandment, Dreamcatcher seems to be doing some serious gymnastics to keep themselves in the game. Let's go back in time. August 9th, 2014. It all started in the summer of 2014 at the Oak Valley Summertime Festival. It's nighttime and the stage is dark.
2014 was 7 years ago. Holy shit.
Next performance. Lights up. 5 girls
in
what can
only
be described as pure 2014 fashion take the stage under the name Minx. They perform 3 songs, all singing and dancing and smiling at the audience. They laugh, they wave, they joke around with the audience, and everyone seems to be having a good time. And there they go, off into the evening. September 15th, 2014.
Sounds so
foreboding. About a month later, a company known as Happy Face Entertainment announced that that's their new girl group, and they're set to debut that fall. Happy Face has had a decent number of different names, but for the ease of the story, I'll be referring to them as Happy Face Entertainment or just Happy Face. A couple of things to know about them before we get into the goods. Happy Face
different
is not
names.
The richest company, but they're very much average. They're not as rich as Woolum or Stone, but they have enough money to give their artists comebacks and promotion when the board meetings say the omens are right. Happy Face was founded by a production duo called E-Tribe. You may recognize them as the producers of a little song called
Oh shit,
Happy
bro.
Face aren't tiny, they
I knew
aren't
that.
Massive.
Those outfits like reminded
story.
Me of some kind
September
of concept.
September 18th, 2014.
Oh, are these the Dreamcatcher girls? Oh my god, yeah! Yo, they've been around. I know this isn't all of them, but it's like, damn, some of them have been around, bro.
Minx debuted as a 5-member girl group with their song.
That song was kind of hard, though. I'm not gonna lie.
The song was pop influenced by hip hop, and the music video followed a pretty standard 2014 concept, complete with the shorts and sweaters combo and thigh high socks. Oh, and the random shots
That's
of
so
girls
true.
In packaging. Remember when that was a thing?
Yes. Oh my
the
god,
bro. The
group
promoted their debut for over a month,
that
finishing off
crazy.
In late October. Right now, Minx look like a proper mid-2010s girl group, a Baby Girls Day or Sistar.
Bro, I miss Girls Day and Sistar, man.
Including, but
damn,
not
they debuted in that era,
good,
bro.
Laboon,
that era feels
Mama
like a
Moo,
long
Lovelies,
ass time ago.
And Red Velvet. The song didn't have a mini album, which may or may not have been the bestest idea ever, as the song didn't quite manage to chart during the quarter. But being a debut, there was room to grow, and maybe fortune would favor the bold. July 1st, 2015. Or maybe not.
What are these scary
later,
ass transition
their first
sound
album,
effects,
Love
bro?
Shake in July of 2015. The song and music video were all about summer romance, and the whole thing resembled an appeal to the many,
man. That
many
that year was all about
innocent
summer
concepts
songs,
of
man.
Summer girls looking for love. Now, we've talked about the 2015 scene before, but let's take another look at it. Oh My Girl debuted, Twice debuted, Red Velvet released their first full album, Girls' Generation released Lionheart. Both musically and visually, Love Shake didn't stick out from the pack.
That is a lot of releases.
The whole thing was later described as a red ocean, meaning that there was absolutely no space for a concept like Minx's to stick out with everyone else in the industry.
Whew.
What Happy Face really wouldn't want right now is one of the most powerful groups in romance and dance genres to debut within 20 days of this comeback.
Bro, I can't believe this was their initial concept.
So also G-Friend, bro. G-Friend, one of the most powerful debuts of the year, occurring in the same month. Let's talk numbers. Eliminating the outliers, the average sale count for a girl group debut album in 2014 was around 3,700.
Damn, Lovely's was up there.
In 2015, the average was roughly 5,060, with outliers eliminated. Minx's debut mini album, Love Shake, made under 2,000 sales. That's under average for both 2015 and 2014. Not the worst, but not the best. Now, for a lot of groups, this is unfortunately a symbol of doom. It's much harder to keep yourself afloat without some form of album unless you're a big three group. By splitting off their first song from their first album by nearly a year, it looked like Minx's debut project might have caved in on itself. But the team over at Happy Face Entertainment had kind of an unconventional idea. In November of 2016, Happy Face announced that the group was going to re-debut under a new name. Happy Face pulled Minx from the shelf and got to work.
Yo, shout out to Happy Face if they like pulled this.
An entirely new instrument team was brought in. Super Bomb was brought in to produce new songs. Two new members, Gahyeon and Hundong, were added to the lineup.
Ah,
that's when they were added. 2 months after the announcement was made.
Ooh! Now, don't worry if this is spoilers. I'm gonna watch these probably eventually by themselves. I'm not really tripping too much about spoilers. At the end of the day. Like, it's fine. Oh, shit! Bro, they were, like, on that rock genre from the start, man.
Minx debuted
like,
on
they chose their sound, and they stuck with
they
it.
They weren't the mid-2010s cheerleaders of 2014 or the summer sweethearts of 2015.
Nah, but then they were sticking out, probably.
A group drenched in horror and elegance.
Oh, my God, that is some...
Supernatural. Main vocalist Shion described creepy. Their new music as a style that takes inspiration from metal and rock, especially J-rock,
and mixes some elements say,
with a
like,
core of pop inspired by the mainstream. Happy Face themselves described the music like, as pop J-rock. Rock and rock-flavored girl pop. They debuted with the song Chase Me, and people immediately noticed the creativity of the group's hard-hitting style and old-world-inspired fashion. The group was establishing an anthology, where each girl represented a different nightmare. They weren't coming to you. As stated in their debut, you were coming to them. Dreamcatcher's debut single album, Nightmare, sold nearly twice as many copies as Love Shake,
4,000?
And Dreamcatcher debuted at number 20 on the Gaon album chart. Remember when we talked about fortune favoring the bold? This was bold.
That's definitely
so bold
that
bro. Members of the groups themselves
switching from a concept
worried
like
about the
Minx
debut completely
to
falling apart.
What they are now?
However, it seemed the new style was just
Yo,
what the group needed to break
through
the waves of the market and start getting their name out there. That's taking New Year, New Me to a whole different level. In April, Dreamcatcher came back with Goodnight and their second single album, Fall Asleep in the Mirror. Once again,
and it's not like they're half-assing this concept either. Like,
sound,
they fucking sued this concept.
The story of their last one, where they finally
like,
hopped on the good foot
well.
And killed that guy. Now all they really needed was a debut mini album, preferably without the 10-month wait in between. At this point, it had already been around 4 months.
Then five, then six.
Ooh, got it in just before 7. Dreamcatcher's first ever EP, titled Prequel, hit on July 27th with the A-track Fly High. Prequel hit like a grenade, peaking at 4 in Korea
and selling
over 11,000 copies.
That's actually
Remember
really
what
good for like
was for the industry
relatively
at the time? Coming back wasn't just about returning to N Countdown or Music Bank.
Oh
no,
my
no.
God,
was
that's
the industry at the time. Coming back wasn't just about
Man, I'm still not like quite up to par with recognition between like their names and like who they are, but this girl is so
and Countdown
pretty.
Or Music Bank. No. It was about getting on the damn plane and getting yourself a ticket to the Western Ooh. Music market. Boom. The album hit top 5 on the Billboard World Albums and went number 1 on the US
oh,
iTunes
shit. Wait, what
chart.
The fuck?
iTunes was still a thing at this point, if you're wondering. All in all, it was a pretty
number
successful comeback.
One.
No, the girls weren't doing G-Friend numbers or anywhere near the top 3, but the album performed well enough that in August, Happy Face announced that Dreamcatcher was getting a world tour.
What year is this again?
October 2017. Dreamcatcher
Damn, they're almost what the fuck? At this point, they still haven't had a win, bro.
To
Yo, they turned the fuck up after like the new group project pretty after quickly the after becoming Dreamcatcher.
It had been important during That's those crazy. First few years for them to appear as one solid team that wouldn't crack under the pressure of a demanding market. But now, with a slightly more stable grip on their group identity, they would need to flesh out their public images as individuals. Up until now, Dreamcatcher had largely stayed within their own bubble. In early October, Happy Face announced that Dreamcatcher and other Happy Face entertainment artists such as D-Once and trainee group HNB would be joining the ranks of Mix 9, a survival show created and owned by YG Entertainment. The goal was to promote the group on widespread television,
Shit,
show off
no
different sides
idea.
Of the group, and most
I knew about this show,
give
but
the public a taste of what Dreamcatcher members were
I actually
like
didn't watch this show, but I didn't.
Mix 9 was a
I just
sandbox
assumed it was
for
kind
idols
of like
various companies to show off not only their physical skills, visuals,
show.
And overall idol appeals, but
I
also
didn't know
start
they were invited
their
like actual pre-existing
One
idols.
One of the key necessities to longevity in the industry is Let's personal see. Attachment. Much of the K-pop industry is designed to sell fans an idol, a person to get attached to. For a group like Dreamcatcher, advertising your own personalities is crucial to drawing in fans who might not know or otherwise care for your music.
Oh,
fans
shit.
Are more likely to support a group they feel personally connected
Facts.
To and involved with, and this
Facts.
Is extremely notable about girl groups in particular, which can sound pretty Machiavellian, but that's another can of worms. What it meant for Dreamcatcher was that the fans who enjoyed the group at large and the potential fans in the making could see the members' personalities and become more attached to them. It would give Dreamcatcher 7 more selling points. On top of that, a show like Mix 9 would, in theory, contribute to the message that Dreamcatcher were committed to impacting and succeeding in the market.
Damn,
by getting together
fire.
Idols from all over the industry
then
to
this
mingle
is like
with
some hip-hop type concept,
each other, Mix 9 would, again,
Just from
in
looking
theory,
at their
allow the members of Dreamcatcher to announce themselves as integrated players within the business, true competitors with skin in the game. Mix 9, like the Produce series, was a unique space for seeing idols outside of their own groups and allowing fans to get
okay.
to know Dreamcatcher through groups they already loved.
Okay.
It appealed to many fans to see their idols friends with other idols.
Bro,
and it was
I did not know
idols
this was what Mix 9 was about. I
just
assumed Mix 9 was like
the show began
another
in late
like
October,
Produce
and four members
type
of Dreamcatcher, Jiyu, Shiyun, Yuhyun, and Dami, were there to compete against 94
Ooh,
other female idols.
Okay.
Talent-wise, it actually went pretty well. The members were recognized for their skills
region?
And development, each one receiving a rank of B or higher. Out of the 98 female participants, Yuhyun ranked in the top 9 during the showcase section,
Damn.
And Jiyu ranked at number 4 in episode 4 and number 7 in episode 5. Things were just starting to heat
hey, that's
up.
Not bad,
there were
bro.
Some great performances and some rather awesome moments from both the members of Dreamcatcher and the other idols
sway.
They were working with. Win or
bro,
lose,
she like,
joining Mix 9 would only
oh
serve
my
to help
God.
As long as everything went according
that
to plan.
That shit was tough, bro.
Well, about that.
About
three
this?
Quarters of the way into the show, Dreamcatcher's activities in Mix 9 came to a sudden
Why?
Halt. Practically out of nowhere, Dreamcatcher packed up their stuff and never
the
returned.
Fuck?
Happy Face released a statement saying they were officially pulling Dreamcatcher from the show, and instead, the four girls would rejoin the other members and participate in a tour through Brazil. It was
Why?
A mixed bag, to say the least. While a tour would certainly bring in more money, there was a goldmine of potential publicity to be found in Mix 9.
Bro, they were on the come
up,
man.
The members had accumulated decent rankings, and presumably the other industry benefits of joining Mix 9 would have strengthened as the competition continued. With just 6 episodes left, the decision seemed dicey. Until, well, I don't even need to tell you, do I?
Until what? Oh shit, that happened? What? Bro, they dodged a bullet, bro. I didn't know that happened with Mix 9. Bro, what? That's actually crazy.
Mix 9 flatlined and everything went kaput. Upon finishing its run in December and announcing the winning group for debut,
what?
YG Entertainment canceled the entire
what?
Project. Money went down the drain. Months of time spent was now wasted.
Bro,
and YG stock completely
I had
crashed.
No idea.
The
they dodged
and
a bullet, bro.
Were screwed to high
Yo, Happy Face is low key like
purposes,
selling me as like a
go
company,
the
bro.
Just
like,
before the
they made
exploded.
All the right decisions, man. Changing the concept, pulling them out of that fucking mess of Mix 9, like damn bro. Happy Face, oh shit.
Now it's true there's no way Happy Face could have
foreseen oh shit
this.
Oh okay.
In fact, the idol who ranked highest in the
I thought they did
show was Woo Jin Young, and three guesses what company he came from. It can't be stated enough how damaging the failure of Mix 9 was to its participants.
Bro, I thought Happy Face was on some psychic shit.
Happy Face himself proceeded to file a lawsuit against YG Entertainment for 10 million won. Later, Happy Face started to reveal a fuck ton of the underhanded actions done by YG during the course of the show.
No surprise there.
Including but not limited to, YG unfairly extended contracts management period from 4 months to 3 years, which is extremely dangerous to smaller companies. They coerced Happy Face and their artists into agreeing to the new terms under the threat of cancellation, refused to fulfill their side of the agreements by covering fees such as transportation, training, clothes, and so on, and refused to pay any of the money that was owed to Happy Face for use of songs, trainees, and other material. Happy Face described the entire process as the overuse of power by a large entertainment agency with strong influence. Happy Face said this of the lawsuit: "More than to be compensated for all the damages we have received, this is a symbolic amount filed in our hopes that Korean popular culture will progress healthily without the overuse of power by large companies." In early 2019, we would find out that Happy Face withdrew this lawsuit,
and there's
definitely some speculation about what went down behind closed
doors.
They
get, like, threatened by YG or something?
Regardless, it was a disaster. Now let's get back to Dreamcatcher. In all honesty, it seemed that Dreamcatcher had miraculously dodged
a bullet and were promoting
their music internationally with the Fly High World
Tour. Oh my god, I had no idea
by
that transpired in, like, 2019.
Luck, Dreamcatcher were out promoting in the world, and by the end of the year, the world was starting to pay attention. Chase Me was included in Billboard's Best
2019 was around when I heard
19,
like mentions, like little tidbits of Dreamcatcher's name being mentioned.
Things were starting to look up.
Like I knew they existed, but I didn't know much about them. You know,
Dreamcatcher celebrated their first anniversary with a fan meet. All 400 tickets sold out within minutes.
Hey, let's go! Oh my god, Dummy! Is that Dummy? I hope
they're
not embarrassing myself.
Dedicated fans.
Oh no, bro! I'm not sure, but they look amazing, man.
Celebration included the release
these
of
outfits in general
material,
are fire.
New photo shoots, and the release of their fan-dedicated single, Full Moon. There was also an announcement of a March comeback. Time passed, they wrapped up their tour activities, and March arrived. They released their official name for the fan base, but no comeback. The month went on, no comeback.
How long did this go on for?
And still, no comeback. Eventually, Happy Face announced that the album had been delayed, were starting to get antsy. Dreamcatcher did not have a good history regarding album delays, and the last thing anyone wanted was a re-debut.
Maybe I was hyping up Happy Face too early.
Moving into May, Happy Face was utterly vacant. None of the members were making
announcements.
Silence was starting to scare people.
Goddamn.
What the hell was going on? Finally, something gave
way. Man, this narrator is really into this, bro.
Told the fans that Dreamcatcher were named ambassadors for Microsoft's blockchain security technology.
What?
And everyone said,
"Where's the album? We want the album."
Oh, shit.
Come on, this isn't a comeback. Where's the comeback? I thought we were getting a...
Bro, their MV production has always been on point, man. What the hell?
And then Dreamcatcher dropped You and I.
Yo, that song gave me like
some serious anime music vibes, bro. And a hit on the charts. The comeback peaked at number 3 on the Gaon chart and debuted at number 7 on Billboard World Albums. The comeback centered around their iconic sound while also playing well to industry interests. The styling, choreography, and album maintained
while
also imbuing them
bro,
with
she's spinning that thing around like it ain't no problem,
two of
bro.
The hottest dishes on the table at the moment.
Oh my
god. The comeback
god.
Sparked heat in the industry, and the fanbase expanded into the mainstream. This was a good sign, because despite the touring projects Dreamcatcher had done the past year, they had yet to solidify a foothold across the ocean. You and I didn't draw blood in just the Korean market. Suddenly, the international fanbase was stoked from the embers, and Dreamcatcher rose from the ranks of cult favorite to commercial success. It was
Yo, have you
more
have
like
y'all seen the Dreamcatcher robe and lightstick?
They had a really
literal
week.
Cult favorite.
And when I say a week, I do mean
bro, they about to have their fandom wearing
for
robes.
For 7 days, it was Dreamcatcher's world. They received their first ever nomination for a win with You and I, and then
yeah, you just can't be BTS, man. They were just unlucky then.
To be fair, it didn't matter who you were. You were shunted out the door when Love Yourself
Bro,
Tier dropped.
You just can't be BTS,
disparity.
Man.
Now we're gonna hit some confusion in the storyline. Sensing the growth of their popularity, the group went into something of a frenzy. riding the high of You and I, they released a third mini album in September as part of their What comeback.
Ooh. You know what? These song snippets aren't really spoilers. These are low-key like teasers, bro. They make me kind of excited to watch them fully.
The album charted at number 2, which remains their highest position of all time as of the making of this video. They had a Japanese debut, and while they were met with some initial success, the activities in Japan remained largely unrealized.
Bro, 2019. Before going to the West,
they had another comeback on February 13th, 2019, if you're trying to break through another market other than Korea. And its single, Piri.
Japan is the way to go. Okay, give that girl an Oscar, okay? Woof!
I believe this is when Happy Face rebranded as Dreamcatcher Company, but some sources also say that it was a sub-label known as Dreamcatcher Company.
Wait, their company is literally Dreamcatcher Company? Happy Face.
And then off they went on yet another tour.
Deadass?
Here's where things start to get Shakespearean, and I mean that in the bucket loads of pathetic fallacy way. And no, pathetic fallacy has nothing to do with the word pathetic, meaning desperate or depressing. Rather, everywhere Dreamcatcher went, things started to go wrong. Their concert in Jakarta was completely shut down for reasons that were never explained.
Bro, it seems like there's been a lot of like
issues with tickets, and one of the theaters caught fire and burned
what
down.
What the fuck?
Everything was going pear-shaped. After the tour, more Japanese promotions were released, but they went nowhere. In hopes of reigniting fan morale, the group opened applications for their official fan club that summer. But even then, little news came out of it, and the whole affair slipped under the waves. While Dreamcatcher seemed to be anywhere and everywhere, and their comebacks were reaching decent upfront numbers, there was something off about their success. No matter how frequent the comebacks or how long the tours, Dreamcatcher couldn't seem to create a sense of longevity. The spaghetti wasn't sticking to the wall, and after a few weeks of
initial
success,
Dreamcatcher's
prominence would fade and take a backseat to everyone else in the industry. They seemed to be relying almost entirely on reappearance power, but in the grand scheme of things, it seemed that not many people outside the immediate fandom would notice that they went silent. Dreamcatcher's streak of good luck had short-circuited.
They tried doing the YG strategy with Blackpink.
It was time to take a break, get some air, and come back when everyone was good and ready. In the meantime, Happy Face did what they do best. Something unconventional. Happy Face started having board meetings with Vespa, an indie game developing company based in South Korea.
Oh shit.
Hello. Yes, handshake. A handshake for you.
I like your tie.
I'm not wearing a tie. Have a handshake.
I heard the food would be provided.
I lied. Hello.
Your hands are very warm.
What if we kill one of the members and have her come back from the dead?
So here's my idea. Give Chiyu a big fucking sword.
Yes. Exactly.
Brilliant.
I was thinking the same thing.
Fantastic.
That's all I've ever wanted.
Match made in heaven. On September 18th, we finally saw what all those board meetings have been about.
Oh! Bro, this is where I'd be right now. Deja vu. Dude, this song is a masterpiece, bro. I've listened to it like a couple of times after reacting to it. Bro, just like the instrumentals, the composition.
Dreamcatcher had done before. The comeback was a collaboration with Vespa's mobile game.
Bro, then Deja Vu must have been like hype as fuck for like Insomnia's music video.
That usual Dreamcatcher core was now combined with an emotional ballad. And it gave them their first charting song in the K-pop 100.
The
album Rate of Dream hit number 3 and became their highest selling album of all time. There was still one milestone that Dreamcatcher and their fandom had yet to crack. A win on a music show.
You know, at this point, fuck a win, bro.
Year, but hadn't quite managed to snag one. With the emerging success of Deja Vu, they might have their shot. Deja Vu,
you know what? It's good that they should get a win.
The show.
Just to
and
like.
And many fans crossed their fingers in hopes that Dreamcatcher would take home their first
just
win.
Just to like have a win,
that
but
night.
Honestly.
Oh.
5,000.
여기에 생방송 중 집계된 실시간 앱 투표 점수를 합친 결과 더쇼 트위스트의 주인공은
Bro, by 11? Oh my god, that's crazy. Yo, that was a chance.
Taking home their first ever win.
Shit.
I'm gonna label this entire section alleged.
Oh,
there are
shit.
Details that can't be confirmed about certain parts of this issue, and there's so many different parts to what
spill
happened.
Spill the tea,
and
sis.
A lot of
let's
it is
go.
Loosely translated from Korean into English. I encourage you to do your own research and come to your own conclusions. Anyway, on to what happened.
Don't really got time for that, so that's why I'm here. So,
just a little while after the show announced its winner, fans and non-fans of Dreamcatcher began speaking out against the final scores, claiming miscalculation and even fraudulent behavior. So, there's a lot of controversy surrounding these numbers here. After the controversy gained some traction, a few fans started to claim that these numbers were already confirmed accurate and that the controversy was based on lies. As of now, there is absolutely
to be honest, I have no fucking clue how they even like calculate that these numbers are music show
yes
scores.
If you add these numbers straight down, you do get 7,861 and 7,850. However, the addition of these numbers isn't what the outrage was about. It's that these numbers allegedly should have never existed like this to begin with, and that the calculation that was done to create them was fudged.
Did they release the calculation, like, formula
for this? I'm basically
going to
be summarizing several articles that broke down the calculation process, the faulty results, and why people were saying it could have been intentional skewing. All of this information is readily accessible. I encourage you to look at them. One of the primary articles I'm looking at is this one by XDoubleStar, who, while not a website I'm deeply familiar with, provided a decent amount of verifiable information. I'm going to be paraphrasing a lot from them. Credit to the breakdown goes to XDoubleStar. Basically, row 2 is where fans claim things went wrong. According to XDoubleStar, we can establish beyond reasonable doubt that wrongdoing took place. Basically, three major things happened here. The first is that several points were shaved off of Dreamcatcher's YouTube score. Here is the viewer board of the show. Based on the show's own data, the score Dreamcatcher should have received was 1,472 points, higher than what they were actually...
For the YouTube score going between the Dreamcatcher, did you add 2.263630? Still higher than the fish runner. You know what? I'm just going to trust that there was like some kind of calculation formula that's like verified and tried and true. So yeah, so
I'll get one. Which means the show had data that gave one result, and yet somehow another number showed up. But the second thing happened in the category expert preferences.
That's fucked up.
What is expert preferences? It's basically a category where the broadcast can award points to groups based on what they claim are preferences of experts. But this category has long been disputed by practically every fandom in the industry and even some companies, and is largely considered a place where shows just skew points to favor certain groups. In this episode of the show, CLC and Everglow both received full scores of 1,500 points for expert preference, and Dreamcatcher received a zero.
A fucking zero? Not even like a one?
Dreamcatcher still would have won. In order for Dreamcatcher to receive the lower final score that they did, the experts had to have given them less than the minimum amount of zero and then masked it by announcing
zero.
But
they gave them a negative fucking value?
And again, these are all just claims as far as I know. Let's say that all the other data the show published in this section, except for expert preferences, was completely accurate.
Allegedly.
Now, let's remember that the minimum score for expert preference is apparently zero. When you calculate the full score giving Dreamcatcher an absolute zero in expert preferences, their final score for this section is 1,972 points. But the final score that the show released for Dreamcatcher was...
Oh, hell no. That 1,972 would have...
122 points
would have boosted them way above Everglow.
How did the show give them a score over 100 points below the minimum? Fans are saying that they gave Dreamcatcher negative points
That's
in the category.
That's fucked. What
Allegedly,
the hell?
Dreamcatcher was given negative points in a category where you can't get negative points, which would mean what? That their score was deliberately subtracted. Dreamcatcher would have been given a false score on behalf of the show. And if these weren't simple computer errors, this would be cheating. Several fans and non-fans alike recalculated
but why,
the scores
though?
Using
what
the
fuck?
Minimum possible
Who's
of
benefiting
1,472 points. And based on the results, even if Dreamcatcher had scored an actual zero in expert preference, which again is absurd to begin with, they still would have beaten Everglow for first place. This led many fans to conclude that the show fudged Dreamcatcher's score and even subtracted points from it so that they could edge them in just under Everglow. If this is what happened, subtracting points from a group's score
what
is tampering with a group's
fuck?
Ability to win, and that directly impacts a group's success Bro. In the industry. So it's not really a surprise that some fans were disappointed and untrustworthy after the strange results were posted. Now, it's time to remember that this is not, under any circumstances,
yeah.
Everglow's fault.
Yep.
Everglow as a group had absolutely nothing to do with the way the show's scores were calculated.
I'm gonna keep it 1,000 here. Just like the narrator said, it's nothing against Everglow's Everglow as like the members themselves. But I heard a lot about how Yuehua Entertainment, the company that Everglow is under, I heard a lot about how they be buying hella YouTube views, you know? And it's nothing against them. Like I said, hopefully there's no like Everglow fans or anything. But bro, it's pretty much like a thing that Everglow's company buys views. So I'm gonna guess that has something to do with, I'm gonna guess that has to like correlate with this tampering, alleged tampering. So yeah, you know, I'm just speaking out my ass though, so who knows.
And no one can deny that they are a monster rookie group.
Yup, they are killing it though. Like, they got a very strong core fan base. And their songs are bangers. Fire song.
Especially regarding all the heated tensions around rigging right now. And of course, this is not the first time a music show has given a win.
As an Eyes One fan,
in May of 2016,
I get fucking PTSD by the word rigging.
AOA for good luck, when the actual win belonged twice for Cheer Up.
Oh shit. In May
of 2019, Mnet's M Countdown gave first place to New East for Bet Bet, when the win really belonged to Oh My Girl for the fifth
bro,
season.
Bro, so what they really need are fucking, they need to hire some mathematicians, man.
The difference, of course,
there's a lot of miscalculations on these music shows.
About the miscalculations. And corrected the math, as well as the true holder of the win. As of the making of this video, SBS and the show.
See, man, look how happy they are, bro. Like, you can't be
in
mad
fact,
at that.
The only acknowledgement the show gave to the controversy.
That's like genuine happiness on Everglow's face.
Aggressively mocked the group and the fans for the loss of the first win. And that was that.
What?
2020. So what's up with Dreamcatcher now? Based on sheer numbers alone, Dreamcatcher is a decently successful group. Their continued sales presence puts them just under Lovely.
They're up there. They're up there.
And Idol. Given their commercial
sales, rest in peace AOA, but you know.
Oh
god, I'm getting
soon.
Fucking, I'm about to get clapped in the comments, bro.
Narrative comes from a lack of blockbuster success internationally or top three status, and as such causes them to fall into the shadows in the eyes of many international fans. It could also be, and this is my personal hypothesis, that many of the struggles Dreamcatcher has gone through point out a distinct attempt by shadier parts of the industry to stifle the growth of an unconventional group. The industry thrives on convention, unfortunately, and deviations from the norm are often denied, sabotaged, or shut down.
Yeah, but if the deviation from the norm is fucking fire, then
Dreamcatcher has survived
by all means, man.
Dreamcatcher are something of an utter fascination. Ever since they first appeared as Minx, they have been doing some serious parkour to keep in the game. Rolling, flipping, and flat out vaulting over Disbandment like they're in the goddamn Olympics. It's pretty damn impressive, I think. So here's to you, Dreamcatcher. Right now, you might be K-pop's Leonardo DiCaprio, but you are by far some of the most unkillable girls in the game.
For real, bro.
What you did to that one guy. Dreamcatcher have announced a Japanese comeback this upcoming March, and let's hope that.
Now I see why y'all are so fanatical about these girls, man, and with good reason too. Like.
That's all from me this time. Best of luck to Dreamcatcher.
It's just human nature it's just human nature to want to like defend people who are getting fucked over. And not only that, they're so fucking talented and their music is dope. Man, like, I'm so glad I reacted to this, actually. Like, you know what? I'm just gonna, going ahead, I'm just gonna not, like, give a fuck about spoilers and songs and stuff. Because at the end of the day, like, while lore and stuff is important, like, I'm just trying to consume their content, you know? I'm not watching a... Again, not to shit on like all the lore enthusiasts and stuff, but like at the end of the day, I'm just trying to watch some shit, you know? I'm just trying to watch their content, and I will enjoy the lore when it comes to me, but you know, spoilers are spoilers. It's not a big deal, man. It's fine. But yeah, definitely more expect more Dreamcatcher content. And yo, I'm not gonna lie, I saw the Dreamcatcher robes and I might have to cop just for the robe, bro. Bro, nobody's doing it like Dreamcatcher, man. They be selling robes. It's crazy. But yeah, that's gonna cap it off, guys. Thank you for watching, staying till the end if you have stayed till the end. If you like this reaction and you want more Dreamcatcher content, like and subscribe. I'll see you later. Peace out, y'all.